being our God and our Father who provide, sustain, and continue to lend us moments and opportunities because we belong to you, to celebrate who you are. Thank you, Lord, because part of the great blessing you have always blessed us as humanity is the blessings of family, where children are born and are raised and are prepared to become great people in their own time. We are gathered here in this our girls' school to celebrate you for each one of them and to thank you for their parents and for them, oh God, individually, because that's the very reason why this school exists, to be a place of learning for them generation after generation. We want to thank you, Lord, for the teachers who have given themselves selflessly and committed all their time to nurture them, to teach them, and to move them up. And as we gather today to make this school a better place, Lord, may your blessing be upon each one of us. Use me as you will to speak your word, the word of life, to all of us, that we may have and enjoy life in this world and in the world to come. In the name of God the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please let us be seated. My Lord Bishop, of the Bishop of the Diocese of Southern Nyanza, Mama Aida Odinga, all invited guests who have come to join us, our members of Parliament, Board of Management, teachers present, and our students. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Bwana Yesu asifiwe.
Amen.
My name is Jackson Ole Sapit, and by the grace of God, I'm the Archbishop of the Anglican Church of Kenya. And I praise God for being here in your midst today to share in the joy of gathering to make this our girls' school a better place, even with the little contribution that people will bring today to make things happen as they are already happening. Our year 2021 as a church, we have dedicated it as a year of wholesome education, and we call it education that transforms. For the Bible teaches us in Romans chapter 12 verse 1, that do not follow the patterns of the world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, and you may be able to know the perfect will of God. So there is a direct connection between the mind and the heart, that when the minds are transformed for us to know what is best for us, and is connected to what God wants to teach us, then we take it to heart, and then we shall be able to know the perfect will of God. And God has a purpose for each one of us. And today as we gather, and as I look at each one of you, in your eyes, your smiling faces, who do I see? I see a great people connected to God himself, where normally we want to say the sky is the limit, but I want to say heaven is your destination. Is that going to be true?
Yes.
Will you trust in that God?
Yes.
That where he is our destiny.
Yes.
I also don't see people who belong to Oriri. I see girls belonging to the big cities of the world. As great engineers, are you going to be engineers?
Yes.
As great scientists, are you going to give us a solution for COVID-19 and other viruses?
Yes.
I'm seeing great people who are going to make the world a better place. For it all begins here. Where you are today, it all begins there. Learning one subject after the other, not only the subjects in school, but the subjects of life, will always grow us from one place to another, and we shall be able to grow and become. I want to thank God for the opportunity and the invitation I got through the bishop, but through P.S. Owino, who is a great family friend, and we are a team of us who are real friends. And somebody said, Okeo carries the bag of the bishop wherever he goes. He didn't mean the bag of our bishop Simon. He was meaning the bag of the archbishop, because we have always been seen together, working and serving the community together. We have been here before, And when P.S. Owino asked me that I join him when he's coming to fundraise for a school bus, I said I'm glad he'll be there, because this year is particularly so important to the Anglican Church, where we are celebrating wholesome education, and education that transforms. And we want that transformation to happen to all of us, and each one of us. I know we have a very limited time because of the day has progressed and the rains are coming, but allow me to say, I am also a father, and therefore I'm speaking to my children the way I'll speak to those who are in my house. You are all my daughters, and I want to thank God for each one of you. I want to bring the story read to us of this young man called David. David was a young man from a very normal family, not a very high-end family, a normal family of a man called Jesse. When King Saul was not doing right in his position as a king, the Lord sent Samuel to go and look from among the sons of Jesse one he would anoint as a king when he was a tender boy. Samuel came to him, to that home. Jesse brought his big sons, those who are already big enough to be considered to be king, the most tall and the most handsome, and presented over to Samuel. But none of them was spotted as the one God has directed. And he asked, "Do you have another one?" And it was said, the man was disturbed because he knew the only one who is not there could not fit to be a king, because he was just small, a little boy in the field tending his sheep. But when he said, "I have one, but very small," he was told, "Reach out to that one." And David was brought. The particular part of life of David I want to turn our attention to was when the children of Israel were facing a very big catastrophe. The Philistines have fought them in battle. They defeated him, and they took away the Ark of the Covenant, which in those days represented the presence of God. So Israel was left a people without a God. Their God is conquered, or their God is taken away, and their hope is completely dashed, and they have nowhere to turn to. Even more so, the Philistines still wanted to come and pursue them and finish them off. And they invited them for battle in this great valley. And every morning for 40 days, their champion, the Bible says so, their giant, a man called Goliath, whose description of how tall he was, how big he was, even the length of his spear was given by the Bible, came to challenge the children of Israel every morning and said, "Bring your man, I want to face, and whoever challenges me will have taken over and won over the Philistines. So we need now a big war that everybody is going to fight. Let your champion come, I fight him, or he fights me. Whoever wins, their community or their nation wins." And therefore the challenge was put forward for 40 days. This young man was still in the field, looking after his father's sheep. And the father called out to him and said, "You know, we are not hearing what's happening in the battlefield. Your brothers are there. I want to send you some provision, little food for them. Go and check out and bring me back the report, what might be happening." I kept on wondering, how did this old man trust a young boy that he'll go to a battlefield and bring a report? Maybe he has already known the courage of his son, that he can go even if the war is on in the field and in the valley. So the boy came, and he came and watched, and he found the drama on. And this was a drama. Goliath is coming out again to bring a new challenge. "Let your man come out. Today I want to challenge you. Days are going. I want to see whoever is going to defend you. Let him come." And what he saw in the camp of the Israelites was a people gripped with fear. They cannot match this man. They cannot produce anybody. And the king began to make even appeals. "If anyone's come, I'm going to give a daughter for marriage, you know, a form of bribery. I'm going to give portion of the kingdom. I'm going to give whatever the spoils that we are going to get in this war, whoever comes." So the king was helpless. He did not know where to turn to, and he was turning to his people one after the other, asking, is there anyone who can challenge this man? So the little boy stood there and listened to the conversation, saw the desperation of the king, and said, I want to come forward. How can you all stand? A nation that believes in God, a nation that has a God who has never been defeated in battle, how can you all stand and let this man challenge you without a match of him? So I want you to imagine the size of this boy compared to the size of Goliath. The entire community was looking for a match of Goliath. Now this boy says, I want to be the match. I want to come forth and be the match and challenge him. And his brothers saw him. And one of them ran and said, are you out of your mind? Who have you left the small number of sheep your father had? What are you doing here? And the little boy said, angry at me. I am the solution of the current problem facing the nation of Israel. And I want to offer myself as a solution to the problems facing us. The problems of our time is that we always want when things are ready, but none of us is ready to become the solution when a problem is presenting itself. We run away from the problem, but when there is plenty, we want to come and scatter and plunder it because it is already there. The boy said, I'm not going to wait until someone challenges this man. I want to be the solution and I want to offer myself. He went straight to the king and said, King Saul, here your servant, I want to challenge this man. And Saul looked at him, his size, and compared the size of the giant, and still, because of desperation, said, are you ready? The little boy said, yes, I'm ready. Saul thought he's going to dress him with all the armor of war and make him ready for war. And they tried. What happened to the little boy? He could not even lift his leg because it was so heavy for him. He cannot carry the spear and the sword of the king. He cannot lift his shield. He cannot carry whatever was put on him because everything was heavy. And he still said, look, the God I believe in does not require this weaponry. He has more power and far much more power than the weapons we want to display before this guy. Now, the rest of that. And the commission is going to have a battle. So, what I'm going to tell you, yes. Goliath right in his forehead. From that day on, the children of Israel triumphed over the Philistines, and he was able to deliver them and became the solution the people were looking for. What we are asking ourselves is, can we become the solution that the nation and the nations of the world are going through? We don't have to become older people for us to become solution. Even the younger person, young as you are, you can still, when you get focused, be attentive to what God is doing and using you, and you can still become the best God wants you to become. But I might remind that you and all of us that the schools we have created are only spaces for learning, and they are created for posterity, not only to you, but to those who will come. Imagine you burning that school, and you are going to found a family. Don't you want your children to come back and learn in the same school you have been? So when you are planning to burn, are you becoming a solution or part of the problem? So let us then therefore focus our attention on becoming the solution of the things that the world is going through today. Kenya, as a nation, we have our own share of challenges and things that are challenging us on a daily basis. You are the future our nation is waiting for. You are the people who have been waited, like the children of Israel, waiting for a savior in that valley until a young boy appeared and became the solution. What lessons do we draw from David. One, he was obedient to his father, and therefore he learned from the teachings of the father. He went to herd his father's flock in obedience, and that obedience made him a big learner, and he took the courage to be able to defend them, even against bears and lions, because he was inspired by what the father had taught him. David inquired about the giant's problem and what was the problem the children of Israel were facing. He asked, what is the problem in this valley? And when he learned, he said, I'm not going to go back to herd when this problem is not over. He was a courageous young man. And none of us can succeed in life without the attribute of courage. So our girls, I want you to be courageous girls who will face that examination and do it with precision and make sure that you excel when that exam comes. David counted the cost before he started. He knew what was needed for him to win. One of the things he knew he needed was the power of God. He relied on God and prayed and called upon the name of the Lord, and he declared, I'm not coming in my power, nor in my name, nor in the trust of the spear, I'm coming trusting God. So our girls, your success is commensurate to the level of trust you put in God. David trusted in God wholeheartedly, and that trust made him a winner. So when you approach life trusting in God, the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth, who makes whatever is ahead of us and level the hills and flatten the valleys, will make you successful. He was able to dispel any form of discouragement, even from his own brother who discouraged him not to go to the battle, and any other noises, including the discouragement of Goliath himself, who was saying, who is this boy you are sending to me? He did not consider himself a weakling. He considered himself a winner even before he threw the first stone and the only stone that delivered the children of Israel. He was able to be clear on his goal. He knew what he wanted to achieve. What did he want to achieve? Victory for the children of Israel. And he knew, I am going forth and nothing I'm going to look but the best. And what was the best? Victory for the children of Israel. I want you to look into your future with precision, a clear goal and a clear focus that this is what I want in life. If it is that A that you are yearning for, tell God, what I want to deliver is an A for myself, an A for my family, an A for my future, an A for Kenya, an A for the nations of the world, because I have what it takes. David had his goal very clear to deliver the children of Israel. He was able to retaliate his confidence by even recalling his past successes. When he was challenged whether he was capable and able to challenge Goliath, what did he say? When I was herding my father's sheep, a lion or a bear will come and normally will steal one or two of the goats, and I will pursue it. And when I catch up with him, I will hold him and rescue the sheep from his jaws. And when they challenge me, I have fought them with my bare hands and killed them. So he recalled that already God has given him some power to be able to fight and face a challenge ahead. When you begin to recall what God has enabled you to achieve in the past, the Lord will grant you more into the future. So looking back to the journey, how you have been supported by your teachers, the marks that brought you to this school will always propel you to greater heights, even as you look into the future. Therefore, I want to urge you to go out now, as David did, and fight in the name and the strength of the Lord and the Lord alone. Amen?
Amen.
Are you going to fight in the name and in the strength of the Lord?
Yes.
Are you going to tackle that physics
problem and defeat it?
Yes.
Are you going to tackle that mathematical equation and balance it?
Yes.
Are you going to work out that biology practical and make it a reality?
Yes.
When you do, with the strength of God and the name of God, you will succeed. It is easy for people to say then, take faith shallowly and say, because I have faith, I'll wait until that day come and I will still pass. That is not how it works. We put faith, but we also put hard work. David said, because I have faith, the giant will fall by himself. Did he say that? He had an opportunity by saying, Lord, I pray that you strike him before I go. Did he say that? He said, I am coming to you. So he was working towards it to achieve the goal. And you work for it. He came. And when the Bible says, when the Philistine drew near to the line of battle, what did David do? He ran fast toward him to gain momentum and put his limb properly. Where did the sword land? In the forehead. Did he hit you twice? Once, and the man fell. He only finished with his own sword. The laughter, the shame, the children of Israel were happy, turned into song of dance and victory. They pursued the Philistines. They chased them away. What did they recover? The Ark of the Covenant. They were able to bring back the covenant of the Lord to themselves. Let me finish with this very short story to illustrate. There was a young girl by the name Kathy Rigby. She was a member of the U.S. women gymnastic team in the 1972 Olympics at Munich in Europe. And she had only one goal in mind, to win a gold medal. She had trained hard over a long period of time, and one day she was scheduled to perform the prayed for, to perform the gymnastic that was her schedule day. She prayed for strength and the control so that she would be able to perform without missing the mark or overstepping where she's needed not to overstep, and to follow the routine without making any single mistake. She was tense but determined not to let herself down, her mother and father who are present in the Olympic Games, and her country. She held herself high. She performed well, but when it was all over and the winners were announced, her name was not among them. Kathy was crushed. Afterward, she joined her parents in the stand, all set for a good cry. As she went down, she could barely manage to say, I am sorry, however, I did my best. She said in a very low, harsh tone. And she told her parents, you know that I did my best. I also know that. And her mother said, I too know you have done your best, and above all, God knows you did your best. Then Kathy recalls her mother's 10 words that she had never forgotten her life through. And these were the words. Do your best. Doing your best is more important than being the best. Doing your best is far much more important than being the best. This hit me one day. I was a student of theology at St. Paul's University. I wrote an essay and I thought I did very good essay. And when it was marked, I got the lowest marks I ever got in that school. And I went to my lecturer. I asked him, what happened? I thought it was the best essay I've ever written. And he told me, let me give you counsel, my son. He took me to a football match. It's like you playing the game of football. If you go to a football pitch, when you have the only one sole goal to win and to score a goal, not to win but score a goal, and your team wins and you have not scored a goal, you will still be miserable. Because your goal was to score yourself. But if you go to play good football and your team loses, and you play good football, you will still hold yourself high because you did well. What I want to remind you, in all your years of study, do your best, let the results speak for themselves. You did your best, that was your mark. Go and work hard next time. What is this story that my story telling us? You know, sometimes we think the mark we get defines who we are. That is not true. We are still far much more capable of bigger things than the mark you get in every exam you sit. So never despair. Work hard after what you get. The future is bigger and brighter. We win not by a single stone like that of David, but trying again and again and again. May God enrich our lives and your lives. May you walk with strength and pride throughout your journey of life in this school. And as I said, as I look at you, you belong to the big cities of the world as contributors of life and making it better. For you are going to be the solution givers, not part of the problem that is facing humanity. In the name of God the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.